this is Bible Academy. I'm Pastor Teacher Curtis Somo, and today we continue our Bible study in the book of Proverbs. But before we get started, we need to make sure that we have confessed our sins, that we are allowing the Spirit of God to control us. Let's pray. Well, Heavenly Father, we thank you again for this privilege and opportunity that you have given us to study your word. We ask that we'll have open hearts and minds to your truth today. In Jesus' name, amen. By way of review, let's look at the first several verses. Verses 8 through 14, where the father begins to instruct the son. Listen, my son, to the instruction of your father, and do not forsake the teaching of your mother. For they are like a graceful garland for your head and a necklace for your neck. My son, if sinners entice you, do not give in to them. If they say, come with us, let us lie in wait for blood, let us ambush the innocent without cause, let's swallow them alive like Sheol, even whole as they go down to the pit. All kinds of precious wealth we will find. We will fill our houses with plunder. If you throw your lot in with us, there will be to all of us one purse. Well, after this is said, the father gives warning to the son. Now, in what I just read, the father gave the son what these criminally minded fools are thinking. They may say some of this in part, though rarely would they reveal all of their intentions to someone they're trying to get them to join with them, but here we have the father's warning in verse 15. My son, do not walk in the way of them. Keep your foot from their path. The idea behind this, do not walk in the way with them, is threefold. It means do not even start that lifestyle or that way of life. Don't begin to behave that way. Don't follow that way of conduct. And on the other side of this, as we will see later, it includes the consequences of that wayward conduct. The father says, keep your foot. The cal imperative of mana. It means to withhold or hold back. The foot in the singular and actually in the Hebrew. And it's indicating a figurative use here for the feet. The idea of getting on that path. Do not even step onto that path. So the summary from our verse would be, this twofold warning tells the young person, do not even start down that path of their way of life. Do not even try to experience it, thinking it will be the last time you do it. It's not something to toy with. Verse 16 gives the hard facts why. For their feet run to evil, and they hasten to shed blood. They are about to get a young man, naive and gullible, on the path of some of the worst crime. Notice they run to evil. They're in a hurry to do something evil. Evil here is the word ra, frequently translated evil. It means a bad and wrong activity of some sort. Here it's moral evil. Or calamity. They're going to do something disastrous to somebody. Now, as we will see later again, this would include calamity falling back on the wrongdoer, the evil person. It can also fall upon others around them, their parents, their siblings, their teachers, those who are associated with this young person. Now, this evil to the Jewish young people in ancient Israel would mean that they're violating the moral code of the Mosaic law. These evil people have no qualms about hurting people to steal their property and wealth. Their idea is that it's just their hard luck. If they fell in our ambush, that's their problem, you see. There's no thinking in the sense of who they're really ambushing. It makes no difference to them who they want to hurt. Now, to today's children, it would include not only immorality, but indulging in the world system that works against Christ and His church. So when it says, "For their feet run to evil, and they hasten to shed blood," they are about to act quickly to seriously hurt someone. And it could include murder. Now there is a, what we call a double meaning here, double entendre. One from the verses that come before this one and the one that comes after these verses. The idea is that this immoral wrongdoer sheds the blood of the innocent. That would be referring to the verses before, but eventuates in his own undoing and his own blood being shed. And we will see that in the verses that follow. So this hastening to act quickly and shed blood, well, it's like a double-edged sword. It goes both ways. Now pay attention to the next couple of verses, because we will see the consequences of his evil come back on him. Verse 17 and following explains how this immoral behavior will come back on them. "Surely it is useless spreading or throwing a net in the sight of any creature that flies." The word "surely" introduces the contrast. The word for "useless," it's useless spreading a net, kinam, basically, for no purpose, in vain, useless. The idea is that birds are smart enough to know when they see a trap for them. They instinctively see that it's not wise to land on or go near where people are throwing nets. When they start seeing things thrown up into the air, that's not where a bird should go. Now, this immoral criminal type is so driven by lust, whether it be for blood or for money, that he actually ignores the obvious trap, and he does it anyway. And the way the father tells this, he's trying to show the youth just how blind this behavior becomes. And not only blind, but just downright stupid. The wise father now closes the argument in verse 18. "But they lie in wait for their own blood." They ambush their own lives. And what the father is trying to point out to the child, and children should hear this, that those who are out to hurt others will only end up hurting themselves, to put it simple. We see these terms that we saw earlier, lie in wait for blood, let us ambush, same two words we saw back in verse 11. But this time, it's their own blood, and the ambush is for their own lives. So the tables have completely turned. The word for lives here, one we see occasionally, nephesh, basically means to breathe. It comes to mean a self, person, persons, that type of thing, their own lives. So those who set this ambush, it'll come back on themselves. Now, much of this proverb will talk about how this happens. This chapter, I should say. Verse 19 gives us the moral of the lesson. So are the ways of everyone who gains by violence that kind of gain. It, that's referring to the gain by violence, takes away the life of the one who possesses it. Let's look at this first phrase. This is a little confusing. So are the ways of everyone who gains by violence that kind of gain. Who gains by violence is a cal participle. The word is betsa. It means to cut off, to gain by violence. It's unjust gain. And so what we have here is the participle followed by the noun of the same root. So it's like saying, and actually, let me just put the literal translation up there. You'll see what I mean. Those who gain by violence, gain by violence. In other words, those who are out to use violence to gain something, they will gain something by violence. And then the follow-up is what's important to see. It, that is, the gain by violence, what they have taken by violence, takes the life of the one who possesses it. So here's a summary of this moral lesson. The moral of the lesson is that anyone who goes down the path of immoral behavior, prompted by greed, those who are motivated to gain money, things, possessions by unjust means, the consequences are that it will come back on that person. We call that poetic justice. Jesus spoke of unjust violence. Matthew 26:52. When he tells Peter, "Put your sword back in its place," Jesus said to him, "For all who draw the sword will die by the sword." What Peter did here was to misuse the sword. Nothing wrong with people carrying swords in those days. That was used for personal protection. But Peter is not fighting criminals. He's not being attacked by someone trying to rob him or kill him. He's not really trying to defend himself, though one might claim he's trying to defend Jesus. But it was not time for that to happen. He did not discern the events as he should. So why did Peter do it? Peter did it probably to defend Jesus. We're not told specifically. But he's overreacting to the unjustness of the authorities, misplaced zeal, not understanding fully that it was time for Jesus to start that final path to the cross. But in rebuking him, Jesus states a very clear principle. For all who draw the sword will die by the sword. If you live by violence, you will die by violence. Galatians 6:7. Do not be deceived, God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, this he will also reap. Because the one who sows to his own flesh will reap corruption from the flesh, and he who sows to the Spirit will reap from the Spirit eternal life. So the idea is that when you take up the sword, when you use violence to do something, to gain something by unjust means, it will come back on you. Now, verses 20 through 23, we come to where we see wisdom personified. Some have called it woman wisdom. I think that's a good title for it, and that's what I call it also. It's like a woman. Wisdom is going to call like a woman. Verse 20. Wisdom calls out in the street. In the public square, she lifts her voice. The word wisdom here, the one we've been working with, is in the plural. Some call it a plural of intensity. It's all-embracing, it's eloquent, it's elevated. It's at a high level at this point, and it calls out. The word ranan means to cry aloud. It cries aloud in the street. Now this word for street, kutz, it means outside. It could include the streets. The idea is that it's out in the open. Wisdom calls out in the street. And then we have, in the public squares, she lifts her voice. The word for lift is actually the basic word for give. In this context, it's the idea that it's shouting loudly, it's crying loudly. Again, we see these parallel lines that help us one clarify the other. In the public squares, the word for public squares is rakab. It's a open place, a plaza. Rakab, an open place, a plaza. And then it says she lifts up her voice. She lifts up her voice. Like I said, that's the word for give, nathan. It means to sound out, to give out. So wisdom is personified as a woman crying out here. Now, when we first started this proverb, we saw wisdom in the home coming from the parents to the young child. Now wisdom is out in public, in the streets, in the public squares, among the marketplaces where people have contact with each other. One of the points this makes is that wisdom is available. And in this case, wisdom is actually the aggressor. Wisdom is doing the calling out. Even if people don't seek it, it still calls out. So the picture is of wisdom standing out in public, calling for the fool, the naive, the stubborn, gullible youth to hear what she has to say. You see, she is there, and she wants your ear. We also see here there's emotion, there's passion. She is really trying to reach people, to appeal to them. She's crying out, calling out to be heard. It comes from many places. Verse 21. At the top of the wall of the noisy streets, she calls out. At the entrance to the gates of the city, she speaks her sayings. Now, at the top of the wall of the noisy streets, well, that's where you might go out towards the gate. And many of the cities were walled for protection. One would stand at the top of the wall, or high point, so everyone could hear. She calls out, she proclaims. At the entrance of the gates of the city, there she is. It was at the entrance to the gates of the city where you would find the city rulers, the administration, where they would hold local courts. Also, where business was conducted among businessmen, trade, contracts might be made. Again, the point, wisdom is available. Wisdom is in the places that we live, where we meet with people, where we operate. In verse 22, wisdom begins to tell us what she's saying. How long, you naive ones, will you love being naive, and scoffers delighting themselves with scoffing, and fools hate knowledge? This is a threefold complaint by woman wisdom. How long will you naive ones love being naive? This is our word pithy, simple-minded or gullible. They love being simple-minded. Cal imperfect ahav, aheb, rather, for love, aheb, for love. So she's asking this question. how long are you going to be this way? Which indicates it's been going on for some time. It includes scoffers, the word let's, scoffers or mockers. They delight. Simple word means they, kamad means they desire, they take pleasure. They take pleasure in scoffing. They enjoy doing this. It's so easy to get sarcastic at this point, but I'll try to hold off on that for a while. Fools, notice, and fools hate knowledge. Here's our word kessel. We saw that in our introduction, if you recall. It had to do with the bear cubs. Now, a kessel, to define it, is a fool, a stupid man, a dullard, and practical things. He can't sort the simplest things out about life. Here we see he hates, and that's the word, sane. He hates knowledge. Now think of it. He doesn't want to learn anything that'll make him better or help him or get him out of trouble or keep him out of trouble. And that's our common word for knowledge, da'at. Fools hate knowledge. And wisdom calls out how long you naive ones will love being naive and scoffers delighting themselves with scoffing. And fools hate knowledge. Three groups are addressed here, the naive, the scoffers, and the fools. The simple-minded, the scoffer who outwardly, verbally mocks wisdom. The fool, the kessel, the one we saw back again regarding, remember, better to meet a bear robbed of her cubs than a fool, a kessel, in his folly. In this scene, woman wisdom has been calling out for some time. How long will this go on? Perhaps as early as 5 or 6 years old to now they're in their late teens, still ignoring the call. The parents have tried to teach them. The dad has appealed over and over. The mother has tried every kind of discipline she can to get the child to listen. The teacher has been unsuccessful. The wise man gets nowhere with this type of person. They can't stand hearing anything that's right. Now, how foolish can that be? So the child continues to prepare to be a failure. He loves being simple and gullible. This is the young person who does not want to learn anything important or worth learning. Much of what they think about is having fun, what they enjoy, fulfilling their lust in one way or the other. They don't want to commit to anything. They prefer their sin. One more thing about the scoffer when it says they delight with scoffing. They crave for the opportunity to mock someone. They're looking for a way to make fun of someone, and they do it. What makes them feel special is mocking someone who's smarter than them. Now, how much sense does that make? But you see, to them, it makes good sense, which to us is nonsense. They would always be making excuses of why they do not study in school or get a good job or stop some dumb thing that they keep doing, like driving recklessly or taking drugs or wasting their lives watching bad movies. They want no moral compass for their life. And fools hating knowledge, They despise anything that is right. They look, act, speak against everything, anything that is moral and makes sense. They want no restraints on their lives. They'd rather have their freedom to be wrong and be advised to do the right thing. Oh, don't you tell me what to do. I'm just telling you it'd be better if you did it this way. Oh, I don't want to do it that way. You see, they have no inkling to accept advice or wisdom. They wish to be unconfined and undisciplined. We would call them wild. So, to use a little more up-to-date terms, they not only want to be an idiot, but they like being that way. That's why they hate wisdom. They're afraid they might not be able to continue to do their stupid things. This is a sin nature run amok. In verse 23, woman wisdom calls again, this time for a change of direction. Turn to my rebuke, then I will pour out my spirit on you. I will make my words known to you. The word for turn, a common word in the Hebrew, is the calamity perfect of shuv. Shuv. It means to turn back, return. It came to mean the term for repentance. Shuv. Turn around. That's the idea. Change your direction. Turn to my rebuke. The word for rebuke. Tokakath. Reproof or rebuke. If they turn. The condition is, then I will pour out the hefil imperfect. The word means to belch, to pour forth, to pour out. That's the idea. My spirit, ruach, common word for spirit, wind, breath. Now, here we see one of those figures of speech we see in poetry. This one's called a metonymy. A metonymy, M-E-T-O-N-Y-M-Y. It's when a word or name or expression is used to substitute for something else. For example, Capitol Hill is a metonymy for Congress. Hollywood is a metonymy for the TV and movie industry. So spirit here is a metonymy for the thinking or thoughts of wisdom. Let's look at our verse one more time. We'll look at some of the points we want to get out of this. 123, turn to my rebuke, then I will pour out my spirit, my thoughts on you. I will make my words known to you. In other words, he's going to understand them. There's still time for this youth to turn back and go the other direction. But time is running out. Wisdom is available and ready to help the youth. But the youth will have to choose soon. Now, if he does turn back, then wisdom will pour forth like a rushing stream. Thoughts of wisdom upon the youth. The words will be made so clearly known that the youth will not forget. That's the idea when it says, I will make my words known to you. You will understand what wisdom is if you turn back. But you see, he has to want it. There will come a point when it'll be too late. And then much of the rest of this young person's life will be picking up the pieces of the mess that he's made from his life. Now in verse 24, we take this to another level. Because now, we begin to see the danger, the grave danger of refusing to listen to wisdom. We're going to see four clauses that describe the continual rejection of woman wisdom. These four clauses amount to four charges. Charges of rejection of wisdom that will result in a judicial sentence. The first two charges are in verse 24. Because I called and you refused to listen. That's the first charge. I stretched out my hand and no one paid attention. That's the second charge. Let's look at a couple of words here. The word at the end of the sentence, paid attention. I don't think we've seen this word here. It's kashab, hifil participle of kashab. It means incline the ears or pay attention to heed. The stretching out of the hand is a gesture with an appeal. You've seen people, perhaps yourself, have used your hands to get people to come along or listen or appeal to someone. That's the idea here. There was a clear calling here that was refused. Notice he said, because I called and you refused to listen. So he's already at a point where he's turned down wisdom time and time again. There was further appeal indicated by the hand gesture that was ignored. We move on to the third and fourth charge in verse 25. And you neglected all my counsel, and you did not want my rebuke. The word for counsels, the word etzah, it means counsel or advice. My rebuke, kind of a strange looking word. Tokakath means rebuke or reproof. So, woman wisdom's counsel, all of it, has been completely neglected. Rebuke is flouted. Time and time again, this person rejected wisdom as it continued to call out. When wisdom presented a clear path to get off this dark life that this person was beginning to lead, their youth rebelled against it. He wanted nothing to do with it. He doesn't want to hear it. He shakes his head, lifts up his hand, shakes his head, and turns away. Now these four clauses also show us a continued escalation of rejection of woman wisdom. So they become an indictment. The reasons he's going to suffer. And now the sentence will be announced. Now let me just pause here to insert something that we talked about in the introduction. Here we see the contrast of the two worldviews. That of woman wisdom that presents wisdom, counsel, direction for one's life, a way to really live well. The other worldview is the absolute rebellion against this wise counsel and a deliberate stubbornness to go one's own way, rebelling against all good and wise words that have called out. In verse 26, the sentencing begins. This may surprise you. Verse 26, listen to this. Wisdom, or the woman wisdom speaks, I will in turn laugh at your disaster. I will scoff when your calamity comes. One of the interesting words here that begins this verse is gam, G-A-M. The translation, in turn, is a good way to put this. It expresses a correspondence here, as in retribution. So, if you do this to me, here's what I will do. That's the idea. Gam. The word for disaster, we will see it now and then. Simple word. It's a common first name, Ed, pronounced Ed. It means calamity or disaster. This is personal destruction on someone. Life is ruined. So, woman wisdom, in turn, laughs at this person's disaster. He's made a wreck of his life. Add to that, there's words besides laughter. The cal imperfect of la'ag. To mock, deride, scoff. She scoffs at this person's calamity. Similar meaning to what we've seen with Ed. Pakad's the word, dread, disaster, fear, terror. Well, let's continue with the next verse before we examine the interpretation here. This laughing and scoffing comes, notice this, it comes at a certain time. It comes at a point in this person's life. Verse 27 describes it. When your calamity comes like a storm, and your disaster, there's our word Ed, arrives as a whirlwind when distress and anguish come upon you. So the laughing and scoffing starts when the calamity hits this person like a storm. Let's talk about these words and these parallel phrases. The word for storm, sufa. It means a whirlwind, a storm. And your disaster arrives as a whirlwind. The word for, disaster. We've seen that before, pakad. Now we have the word distress. When distress and anguish come upon you. Notice this word distress. Sara. It means distress or trouble. And then the word anguish. Suka. Anguish or distress. Now let's look at both of our verses together. I will in turn laugh at your disaster. I will scoff when your calamity comes. When your calamity comes like a storm, and your disaster arrives as a whirlwind. When distress and anguish come upon you. So the laughter and scoffing comes when these events hit this person. Calamity, disaster, distress, and anguish. Woman wisdom laughs. Why is she laughing? Well, first of all, the path of the fool is laughable. It's so absurd. It's so imbecilic to go down this path of the foolish. One can only laugh at such pointless nonsense. I mean, you shake your head so many times and you just say, this person has no idea what life is about or what he's doing or where he's going to end up. Have you ever clearly told someone that if they do something, then they go and do it anyway? You tell them something's going to happen if you do that. And they go and do it anyway. you just shake your head and think, how stupid can one get? I just got to tell him not to do it, and he does it. That's the idea here. But there's some other things here we need to understand. Truth is truth. Not a profound statement. But when the Bible says something is going to happen, you can rest assured it will happen. It's true with wisdom also. If wisdom says you keep going down that path and it's going to destroy you, it will destroy you. So there's a real lesson here. There's no changing the fact or the result of what happens to people when they reject truth and they reject wisdom. The person who rejects wisdom initiates a series of events that will eventually culminate in his own miserable end. Now let me make this clear. It's not wisdom that brings a disaster or destruction on this person. It's the natural results of this person rejecting it. Now, if you're about to step in a big hole in the ground and I say, don't step in that hole, and you go and do it, I didn't make you do it. I tried to get you to avoid it. And you might say, well, if you just told me louder, grabbed hold of me, I said, I yelled at you. You did it anyway. See, the person doesn't even want to take responsibility for their own stupid acts. If a young man goes for the immoral, get-rich-quick schemes that we've seen in this passage already, he will suffer damage. Sometimes it'll be through the law, or he will carry regrets all his life. What this passage tells us is that when a person rejects wisdom, when he spurns good counsel, as a young person, when he ignores the father and the mother, the teacher of God's word, it tells us that his mistakes, his sins, his rebellion will fall back on him someday. That will happen. That will happen. And the only thing that can stop it from falling back on him is an intervention from God. God can fix it. But if one is rejecting truth, he'll reject God. This tells us something about that natural world order. Not many societies would ever accept the fact that you can just steal whatever you want when you want, or murder who you want when you want. That's pretty much a universal rule worldwide. That keeps the world in order. Now, of course, there are terrorists and so on that violate it, but the point is there is a basic world order that keeps the human race within the bounds of survival. But it can only continue if these laws of wisdom remain consistent and intact. So if you were to go down the road and violate one rule after another, you're eventually going to get the consequences of all of that. This is wisdom calling out. You don't have to have someone tell you what's wrong and right all the time. You know you're doing wrong and you like to do it. Maybe you just want to see how long you can get away with it. Have you ever done that? Later on, we'll read a Proverbs chapter 5. Let's look at that. Let's anticipate chapter 5, verses 21 through 23. For a man's ways are in full view of the Lord, and he examines all his paths. The evil deeds of a wicked man ensnare him. The cords of his sin hold him fast. He will die for lack of discipline, led astray by his own great folly. Don't ever think that a criminal will get away with his crime. And one way or the other, he will get caught and he will pay. may not suit you that it takes too long or that the penalty is not severe enough. But God's in control of that too. The laughing and scoffing at this person's personal disaster that we've seen here in our passage, the scoffing at the calamity, so shows us that wisdom is always the way to go. Wisdom said that would happen, and you did it anyway. We see wisdom's victory, that it was right. Wisdom's not beating a dead horse, someone that's down now, but rather expressing the pleasure from seeing the end result that wisdom said would happen. It's a satisfaction that comes when you see a criminal apprehended and then punished, a fair punishment for his crime. Wisdom is sound advice. So when a person rejects it, and then that person's wrongdoing falls back on him, one can just shake his head and say, I told you so. Now this laughter and scoffing happens when wisdom sees this fourfold judgment come on the person. I don't know if you've ever been in a large disaster of some sort, a hurricane or tornado or something else similar. People tell you to prepare. You prepare. This is the type of person that would not prepare. Oh, it's not going to hit me. It's not going to bother me. And they get wiped out, you see. So our fourfold description. When your calamity comes like a storm and your disaster arrives as a whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you, this fourfold description describes without a doubt what happens as a result of walking the dark path. It's similar to seeing justice carried out or one getting his just rewards. Now there's a lesson here for the child and one for the wise adult to realize. When we read this proverb and it says this is going to happen, you can conclude, you can bet your life on the fact that when you make a very bad judgment, you have an affair, you cheat in business, you steal what is not yours, you betray a loyal friend, you mistreat the poor, and so on, you will pay. Proverbs gives us the positive. That's what's nice about Proverbs. It gives us the positive. It also gives us the negatives. But you learn the positive. You live righteously instead of being wicked. You learn instead of being ignorant. You develop wisdom rather than be foolish. Now I'm going to press home the point here. Do you see what's going on here? Wisdom is calling. It is out there calling. Now it's saying, here's what's going to happen if you reject me. Your life will be one wreck after another. You will leave a trail of victims behind you, but it'll catch up to you, and when it does, it will hit you like a storm, a tornado. Distress and anguish like you've never thought could happen. Judgment will come, and it will be terribly painful. Have you ever seen the results of a Category 5 hurricane? We had that down in our direction a few years ago. Levels buildings. All that's left is a foundation. Or an E5 tornado. when one of those are coming, you're underground. You go underground if you plan on living through it. And when you come up and you see nothing except rubble, houses on top of houses, cars gone, sometimes people gone, something you want to avoid. Wisdom is telling you, you're going to get hit by a storm, a whirlwind, if you don't listen to what I say. Now it talks about the anguish and the distress. There's the psychology of this. The being pushed to the brink of insanity. Fearing for your own sanity after you go through all this loss and distress, as you sit there in your jail cell or on death row or with nothing left of your life, your reputation gone, your possessions lost, what you worked for all your life has been ruined because you didn't use wisdom. This is wisdom coming home to roost, to use the saying. Now understand that wisdom will have its way. To the criminally minded, the fool, the naive, the gullible, there will come a time when wisdom will say, I told you so. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your profound words. We thank you for this wisdom. Help us realize that it is a guide to life on this planet, that you have given us all that we need to not only survive, but to live and really live as you want us to. Challenge us with these words in Jesus' name. Amen.